actually great to be here today. I always love coming to these college campuses. It reminds me of my youthful days. As the wonderful girl before me said, that yes, I used to play tennis, and I have grown up in an environment where I was submerged in sport from pretty much age four, and I played very highly competitive tennis and traveled the world and played a lot of in various competitions around the world. Tennis has given me actually everything I am today. I am where I am because of the sport, and I am very, very passionate about that. And not only that, I'm also very grateful for that. It allowed me to see some of the best places in the world. It allowed me to meet some great, great people. It actually probably is one of the reasons why I'm standing here in front of you guys. And when I was near the end of my career, I actually felt that I wanted to do something. And I was one of the lucky few to be able to make a career out of the sport. I was one of the few lucky few who was able to, you know, shape my life around the sport. But I knew the hardships coming through. I knew the challenges that the Indian athletes faced. And I really wanted to do something for them and give the Indian athletes a platform and an opportunity, at least, to be able to achieve the things that they all dreamt about achieving. Do we have to face it, someone? Mahesh Bhupathi was a very close friend of mine and myself. We actually dreamt of this thing called the Champions Trust. And we both actually wanted to do it when we were done with tennis. I was, of course, closer to the end of my career than he was. So we started the trust, and we said, you know, we're going to help different deserving athletes from around the country and try and give them an opportunity to be able to succeed. And it so happened that this was in 2005. We happened to be at Wimbledon, and we were actually sitting in the players' lounge over strawberries and cream and discussing this. And Mr. Mittal walked in with his son and son-in-law and a couple other people. And he sat down. Mahesh was in the final the next day, so everybody wanted to talk to him. And we started, you know, since we were mid-discussion, he continued it. And he kind of piqued his interest and said, what are you guys talking about? And we gave him a little brief of what we wanted to do and how we wanted to help Indian sport. So he thought it was a great idea. And he said, you know, everybody from Suresh Kalmadi down has given me plans of giving them millions and millions of dollars. But if you guys can give me a good plan, I would be more than happy to fund it. And then we name it. Hence, it started being named and called the Mittal Champions Trust. The trust actually started in 2005. I did so much research, and I had no idea about anything beyond a tennis court at that point. So I did a lot of research into what sports we could support, what the exact scenario of sport in the country was, where we stood in terms of talent, and where we, you know, how did we match up with the rest of the world. And what we came up with was five sports. And these are Olympic sports, which not anybody, it was not in the limelight at the point. And sports like boxing, sport wrestling, archery, athletics, you know, shooting was still a little bit in the limelight. But we thought that if we can give these guys and these athletes an opportunity and the facilities they needed to succeed, we could then translate that into Olympic medals. And that was the only goal. We actually didn't do tennis, because tennis players at that point were getting quite a lot of funding from various sources. And the initial starting up of the trust was very, very experimental. We were the first to do it. We had no kind of precedent to follow. And you know, we kind of wanted to learn by trial and error. I didn't know so much about the other sports that we were supporting. So here we are today, actually, two Olympic medals later, one gold and a bronze. And we support 33 different athletes, and it's been the most tremendous journey of my life and what I've learned about Indian sport and where we are. Obviously, our next goal is Rio. We've just finished London, and now to be able to top, you know, we had a career, a lifetime in winning five medals at London. So now we're trying to aim for the double digits in Rio. So sport in India, I mean, it's an awakening, it's a learning experience. There's a lot of, you know, just like every other thing, there's good, there's bad, and there's not so good. I mean, there's the ugly. So I really believe that we have a system in India which is, we're only one of five countries in the world with the present system. And on paper, it's a fabulous system. Sport is taken down to the panchayat level, which is is similar to China, where they take it down to the provinces. And these athletes are given jobs, training centers, which are supposed to be side training centers. They are given full-time jobs where they don't have to attend while they're competing or practicing in their sport. Which is, we are the only country in the world that does this. We are the only country where our athletes are allowed to practice full-time into their profession. The money. And when I started my job, I really believed that all Indian sport lacked was money, and all I had to do was write checks and the medals would come pouring in. That's not true. We don't lack money. The government is now spending more money than they ever have. I think this year's annual budget is going to be something like 600 crores, which is twice that of what we spent during the Commonwealth Games towards development. What I realized we did lack was we don't have good enough coaches. We don't have the expertise. We don't have a plan. We don't have a proper system of development of talent. So while we had enough talent, while we had a lot of the raw manpower, we didn't have a system to harness that. And the biggest, you know, thorn in my whole job is the administration. And most of you guys now are abreast with the whole IOA, IOC scandal. And that is a good microcosm of what is really happening in with our people. These are people who don't really care about so much about the athletes, but just want to be there. And I'm not sure why. So what is it that ails Indian sport? And I don't want to get too negative here because it's all about being nice and happy. But the one thing that does ail is my one word answer, and that's accountability. Until the day when we can tie in results to the performance of athletes, the performance of administration, and performance of anybody who's involved in sport, we are not going to be able to produce sustainable results. On to happier things. The Olympic journey of my two favorite human beings, Abhinav and Yogeshwar. They are our two medal winners, and they're my favorite, not because they won Olympic medals, but because they come from two opposite backgrounds, opposite sports, opposite personalities, and opposite in every way, yet so similar. They both were favorites. Abhinav was the favorite in Athens and missed out on a medal. Most of you, if you've read his book, would know why. And Yogesh was in Beijing. He was a favorite going to Beijing. Of course, Sushil Kumar ended up winning that medal. But they were both favorites in the preceding Olympics and then came to the next Olympics staring health issues. Abhinav I met actually in 2005. He was a defending world champion. And he met me and he had a bulging disc in his back and had not picked up a rifle in 8 months. He told me, he said, you know, I don't think I'll ever be able to shoot again. But I am aiming to be able to go to Beijing and try and, you know, redeem myself from Athens. So we took him to the best doctors in the world. We took him from Switzerland to Australia to various different things. He started working out more than he ever could, had consulted numerous physios. Anybody who could remotely help him. So we went to Kerala to a Ayurvedic place. We took him to Australia to see some expert who's supposedly an expert in the back. We took him to Switzerland who they actually do this interesting thing where they inject different parasite-like things into your bulging disc and then the body expunges all the fluid making the swelling go away. So the technology went on and on. And finally, he obviously shot again, and he obviously got ready enough and prepared enough. And when he managed, and we were in Beijing, the day before his event, he phones me up and he says, Manisha, where are you? And I said, you know, I'm at the mall. And he said, I'm coming to join you. So I said, okay, don't you want to be doing official practice? It's the first day the range is open, and I think that you should practice. He said, no, I'm coming to meet you. Comes to me, we're walking through the mall, and I told him, I said, that's odd, you know, all the other shooters are practicing, why aren't you there? So he said, Manisha, you know, I've spent the last 4 years, each and every day of the last 4 years, dreaming about what is going to happen tomorrow. I have put everything on the line. I have left no stone unturned. So I want to take this 24 hours now that it's right in front of me and enjoy the blood, sweat, and tears, which I thought was unbelievable. He was so prepared that he felt he no longer needed to practice. The rest, of course, you know, at that point I told him, I said, Abhinav, you're going to win a medal. And of course, now I look like a genius because he did. But he is one of the most, to the detail, to the point, and he will take his training to such details that he'll try anything to make himself better. Then there's Yogeshwar. I met him in 2008, just after Beijing. He couldn't walk. One knee blown out, other knee had two cartilage tears in it. I happened to see him in one of these events, and I asked him, I said, oh, so you're getting ready for the next Olympics now? And he says, no, I'm never going to wrestle again. I said, why? He said, no, because my knees, I've seen all the doctors here, and I've seen all the experts in India, and they said that I'll never wrestle again. He says, if you can help me, I will promise you a medal. So that's interesting. I not only helped him, we took him to South Africa, got his knees reconstructed. He worked so hard for 2 years after his knee construction, his rehab. He used to be in the gym for 16, and I'm not lying, 16 hours a day. And he tried anything I told him. We sent him to for different recovery things. We sent him to Georgia for some sulfur springs where you soak your body in sulfur springs. We sent him to get, you know, platelets injected into his knees. We've sent him all around the world. And he never once batted an eyelid. Because he knew, and he said, he was very clear in his head, that he knew that if his knees were healthy, he had the talent to be able to do it. So when he flew into London, and he was the last to fly, he actually waltzed in and told me, Manisha, why are you nervous? I'm going to win a medal tomorrow. So these are the similarities between these two people. They gave up their life, they were ready to do whatever it took, and that is the passion and the pursuit that so impressed me that I cannot think of more deserving candidates to win medals. The ones who I'm really proud of, honestly, are actually the athletes who are not up here. The athletes who have still not won medals, but they're still practicing there each and every day, 24 hours a day, trying to get there. They're trying to live the dream. They're trying to get to the elusive Olympic podium. And these are athletes who, when I met them for the first time, were tribals in Nagaland and Mizoram, who are now walking around downloading songs onto my iPad, telling me which is the best app around. So this is the heartening part which I find about sport in India. Going back to Abhinav and Yogeshwar, I think that, you know, their physios and mental trainers and different people around them do deserve a little bit of credit. I don't think I'm going to have that much time, so I don't want to get into each and every one of them. But I want to tell you guys that an expert team behind you is necessary, no matter which phase of life you're in. And it's the team around you that kind of makes you. Getting to the point of sport and what we can all do for sport. And obviously, everybody doesn't have deep pockets and doesn't want to throw money into sport. And if you really ask me, money is not what we need. We need people who are passionate. We need people who are going to spend some time getting to know a sport. And if you get interested in a sport, to try and take that one step further, find a local athlete, maybe just, you know, go and watch him in one competition. Give him a pat on the back at the end. Find something that, you know, take up supporting the athletes over a period of time, not monetarily, but morally. Take up a little bit of time to learn about them, learn about their journey, learn about their struggle, and, you know, encourage them from time to time. We are the most youthful nation in the country, and it is up to your generation. I'm not going to really reveal how old I am, but it's up to you guys to make the change, and it's you guys who will then ignite the spark that will take our country forward, especially in the sporting arena. Thank you so much.